Hello and welcome to another episode of Coffee Can Investing. My name is Saurabh Mukherjea and with me today we have a special guest, Samit Vartak. Samit is the CIO of SageOne Investment Advisors, founder and CIO, in fact, Samit, I should say, of SageOne Investment Advisors. And you've built for yourself a reputation in the last 5 years of one of the smartest investors in small caps. But from what I understand, Samit, it all started very far away from the stock market. You're a farmer's son, and the years in school were years of hardship. If you can just give us a sense of how did those early experiences of childhood and schooling, how did those shape you and make you the investor that you are today?
You know, my father is still a farmer,
right?
Wow. And I grew up on the farm, and as most of the farmers in India, it's very difficult to meet the ends.
Right.
And same was the case. My father was really different in terms of trying to put us in a better school.
Right.
Most of the schools were free there. The government schools, but he put us in a private school, and there the fees was high, and that was
this is in Maharashtra, right?
This was in Maharashtra, just a couple of hours from north of Bombay.
Okay.
The fees used to be 30 rupees per month, which was really high at that time. This was the 1980s.
Right.
I remember times when my father, because you have to pay the monthly fees, and he didn't even have that much to pay, because most of the farmers, they borrow the next 1 year or 2 years of income through their their society. They have a local village
cooperative
society.
Right.
And most of the income that they make goes back just to pay that. So I remember really tough times in terms of trying to borrow money to pay off. The school used to send reminders of. So I've gone through that kind of a phase where I really valued money, and I knew the value of money. Little money, which for most cities wouldn't even matter, but it helps educate the entire year.
And it's yourself and your brother, right?
My two brothers.
So three of you going to school, private school in rural Maharashtra.
Yes, yes. And the fees weren't that much, but for a farmer, it's a lot. So with that background, I luckily got a scholarship to go to the US, to do my MBA. And I went to the MBA. And fortunately or unfortunately, it was the timing of the dot-com boom. I went in 1997. And then passed out in 1999. That time it was crazy bull market in the US. Every stock which used to be listed, Red Hat, and it used to double or triple on the listing day itself. Everyone were excited. Money making was so easy at that time. And I caught that bug. That was my first experience. Until that time I had really no idea about what stock market is, and I caught that bug. And after I completed, I got an offer because job market was good. I got a signing bonus, which was pretty large compared to my background. So I got a job with PwC as a consultant.
This is straight out of business school.
Straight out of business school.
Right.
And then the timings were so great, and I invested. And MBA doesn't prepare you at all for investments. Right. It just prepares you with just basic theory of, and that too, maybe I would say, one on a scale of 10, what you need to be a real investor. And I started investing, and the first, because it was a bull market, wherever you put, you made great money. And by the time you hit 2000, and the markets got really tough.
Right.
And because it was great market, you could invest on margin. So I did the same thing. And as the market got tough, for me, the investing was, you just read analyst reports or, just see who has the best recommendations and just invest in that.
Okay.
And that was exactly wrong, because I ended up investing in most of the crowded stocks the most highly valued, and by 2001, because of the margin and leverage, I was completely wiped out.
Wow.
All the money that I got signing bonus plus, and that was so excruciatingly painful, because the money that I lost, few lakhs, but that money meant so much
in the context of how you'd grown up.
To some of the farmers, I could see that the entire probably village could have gotten the education, and from that point I said, it was so painful that I said, this was completely gambling, you know, what I did. And that is when my real education of stock investments started. You know, I enrolled for the CFA, you know, I bought all kinds of books that I could during that time. And the next 3 to 4 years, those were the real learning experience for me in the stock market. And the main thing was, you know, I made a promise that I'll never go through this kind of a pain ever in life, you know. And that's, I think, because that education came to me really at the start itself, you know. Not, you know, if I had a great 7-8 years of bull market, probably I would have gotten completely wrong investing lessons. And if I had hit the 2007 or 7-8 kind of financial crisis with that kind of a wrong education, I think I would have been wiped out then, rather than at the start. But luckily, because, you know, I became much more prudent in 2007-8, I did much, much better than, you know, most of the investors.
You mentioned you did the CFA around the turn of the century, 2001, 2003, I guess. You also did a whole bunch of very interesting jobs in America. I think I read somewhere that you worked in Gap's strategy team. That sounds very interesting. Could you just take us through that piece, as to, you know, these employment opportunities that the United States gave you? What did you take away from that? What did you learn from that, which later proved to be useful in your investment career?
Yes. So I'm an engineer. You know, so I worked with Mahindra and Mahindra for a couple of years in Mumbai.
I see.
So I had that engineering kind of a background. So right after my MBA, you know, I got hired for consulting, where, you know, I advised companies, mostly manufacturing companies in the Midwest, you know, based out of Chicago, on their cost optimization, on their, you know, growth strategies. How do you rationalize your, you know, processes, operations? Those kind of things. And I got to work on multiple different industries. You know, at that time, even though Midwest was mostly manufacturing, you know, some dairy farms, there were some, I mean, Toyotas, Chryslers of the world, but there were also some dot-coms at that time. So when you work with the corporations, you know, you almost become part of the management. You get to know how they think, you know, how they strategize, how do they plan their growth. Not, and most of the companies in US, you know, they have global ambitions. So just sitting with them, understanding different perspectives of different kinds of managements, and then working on different industries, that helped me a lot, you know, thinking about business, you know, from inside, rather than just looking from outside as a stock market investor. I think that experience really helps even now, you know, when I look at business. I tend to think from a management perspective, you know, whether they are taking the right decisions, whether they're positioning themselves appropriately compared to what the others are doing in the industry, you know. And that's probably has helped a lot. So that was first part of my experience. And then, you know, anyway, my passion was to become an investor, you know. So my next step was, you know, trying to go more towards finance. So I jumped into valuation with Deloitte. So I did this, you know, with PwC and then Gap, the strategy part. And then with Deloitte in San Francisco, where, again, you know, I have done all kinds of valuation, you know, valuing options, valuing the venture capital investments or the private equity deals, all kinds of complicated valuations of, you know, even the IPs and then the brands. And so I think that, you know, the corporate experience and then the valuation experience, you know, those are the two facets which are extremely crucial in investing.
So you clearly had very high quality experience, work experience in the US. The career was going places, working in world-class firms. What led you to come back to India?
Coming back to India was, you know, a plan which I had set while going itself. So there was no question that I was going to come back. It was just a matter of when. And actually, I should have come much earlier. But, you know, then you also want the kids to be born there and those kind of things. And by 2006, you know, we were all set. And I had, you know, I had done my CFA and then done the valuation. And maybe 2 or 3 years late, but, you know, that was always the plan to come back to India. I mean, at that time, it was, you know, much more patriotic that, you know, I want to come back and, you know, do something for the country. And, you know, that's always been at the back of my mind. I try to do whatever I can, but, you know, that was the driving force behind just coming. It wasn't professional point of view.
So initially, when you moved back, from what I understand, you came to Mumbai, but soon you realized that there were better places to build an investment company than Mumbai, and you moved to that lovely office in Pune, which I visited. How did that shift happen? Most people who want to build an investment firm tend to do it in Mumbai or in Lower Parel, where you and I are having this discussion. Where did that decision to move to Pune arise from?
Yeah, so, when we moved back in 2006, my wife was from Bombay. Mm. I studied most, after 10th standard in Mumbai itself. So there was no question that this is the only city we will ever live in after coming. But, my office when I came back was in Nariman Point. I used to live in, the suburbs. Mm. And travel used to take me almost 1.5 to 2 hours each way.
Yeah.
So it was, I think, one of the most frustrating times, because you are sitting in this, Kalipili taxi,
yeah,
where at that time there was no Ola, but you couldn't read anything.
Yeah.
It was just waste of time, and that too frustrating time just sitting in pollution.
Mm.
And at the same time, there were a few of our friends who had moved to Pune.
I see.
And before that, I had never visited Pune ever in my life. So we used to go for, it's like every Bombayite, you just want to get out of Bombay once.
Yeah, you go to Lonavala and come back.
Right. And so I went for the weekends,
right,
with the kids, and then looking at much greener and much peaceful life.
Yeah.
And for me, as an investor, staying away from too much of noise, I think you become part of that crowded space.
Right.
Whatever you try to isolate yourself, you get sucked up. When more and more people talk about the same idea, you get more and more confidence.
I see.
Investing in that. So Pune has helped me. I mean, that wasn't the primary decision for me today. But once I went back,
quality of life was the primary decision.
Quality of life was the primary decision.
Right.
But the side effects have been that I can focus on my work. I don't talk to the stock market participants much. I rather talk to the companies and just focus on that. Learning about different businesses, their strategies and their positionings and different evolving business, I think that's the most well spent time, rather than trying to talk stock market, where most of the people just talk about timing in the market, whether it's the right time or whether the valuations are right or not. I think it doesn't really help in actually taking the investment decisions.
So that brings me to the next question, right? You clearly have a lot of time and a lot of interest in diligencing a company very thoroughly. How much time do you take to diligence a company or stock before you actually start building a position? And if you could just take us through what are the layers of diligence that you apply before you start building a position?
Sure. So, see, layers of diligence vary a lot depending on which kind of industry it is. For example, I was researching on a pipe manufacturer, structural pipes manufacturer.
Right.
When you meet the management, so see, my diligence always involves, I definitely want to meet the management.
Right.
Visit the plants.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to the operational level managers.
Right.
My main goal is not to get insights into the financials of the company, or it's more to understand the culture.
I see.
For me, there are promoters, when you meet them, you realize that they're too micromanagers. They try to control everything in the company. There are certain managers, who try to delegate, who empower the next level of management. I need to see that in any, because that's the only way you can scale up that operation.
Very interesting.
Otherwise, you will just become a regional player. So I like to see that culture across different layers of management, because that's where you get real insights. If you just end up meeting the promoter of the company, he's too smart. He'll
give you the PowerPoint presentation.
Yeah. And then he would know much more about the business, and you will definitely get biased.
So tell me something, someone like me, I don't have a background, unfortunately, in engineering or in manufacturing.
Yeah.
So I find it very hard to understand what to ask plant managers or foreman type people at a plant. How do you strike up a discussion, a rapport with, say, middle managers at the plant level in a manufacturing company?
Sure. So I think before I go, I spend a lot of time studying, what are the critical drivers. So for example, this steel pipe manufacturing company, right? So here the value addition isn't that much. When you look at
the margins,
the raw material cost,
it
itself is 75 to 80%. So the value addition is much. So the net margin that this company makes, it's going to be just 4 or 5%.
That's right. Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
So then, the cost savings, whether the cost saving is from sourcing the raw material, the cost saving from, getting the best rate in working capital, the cost saving by having the best most efficient manufacturing process. Even if it adds up to 1 or 2% of your sales, it's a huge competitive advantage. So once I know which are the areas, you know, where, so for example, this company, you know, they had the biggest advantage in raw material sourcing, because, you know, they used to buy 10% of JSW Steel, you know, that's the size. And most of the other companies in this industry, you know, were almost going bankrupt, you know, so they didn't have the buying power that these guys, right, these guys had. Same thing, because the balance sheet was so strong, their working capital interest cost, you know, was much lower. They brought in new technology, you know, where you know, in the conventional pipe manufacturing process, you know, it's they manufacture a circular pipe, and once you pass through force, you convert that into a square or a rectangle. Whereas with the new machinery that they bought, you know, you basically directly make it into the shape that you want. The difference is that at the corner, because of the force that is applied, you end up having extra material, you know, which makes a difference of 1% to 2%, wow, which is huge. And the second is the changeover time. In the conventional setup, it used to take 24 to 48 hours to change over. And here, they used to change it in 2 to 4 hours. So with a small batch, you know, you can just take those orders. Whereas you had to reject, even if it's a profitable order, because your changeover time was so high. Right. So once you understand, you know, those, which are the critical factors of that business, accordingly, you got to answer those, you know, ask questions. And in fact, in this kind of a setup, you know, sometimes you don't know technology can, you know, you don't know whether what the management is claiming, you know, whether that's 1% savings or the price advantage that they have is true. So I've hired consultants, you know, paid them lakhs to do surveys at the distributor level, you know, talk to distributors across states, see how, what is the pricing advantage that they have, what is the time to delivery, you know, that they have. So based on the industry, you know, if you don't have the skill set to understand, you hire people. You know, there are people who are experts at a lot of things. But, you know, we try to do that.
So clearly, you're doing a huge amount of rigor on management, on process, production process, manufacturing process. But clearly in small and mid-cap companies, a big call is the promoter, right? Is he able? Is he honest? Is he hardworking? How do you reach a judgment on the promoter?
So I rarely try to take a personal call on the promoter. For me, as I said, you know, I try to see if he's delegating, you know, whether the people under him are fearful of him or they are empowered. You know, I think that's a very important point that I look at. And the second thing is about his strategy and positioning. You know, that's a call that I have to take. Whether, you know, you got to hear his vision. You know, how, for me, the most important thing in any business, that I would never invest in a business where they're not taking market share away from the competition. Irrespective of, you know, what you call moats, they can be the highest moats in the industry, but if they are not taking the market share from the competitor, I will never invest in that business.
Very interesting.
Because that shows me that the strategy that they have, it's working. You know, you got to see the results. Right. You can't just base it on, because there are brilliant moats like a Hawkins or, you know, what have they done with it? You know, they have lost market share. So just having a great brand doesn't mean that it's a great mode and you got to pay high valuations for those.
So you're businesses. Saying we can look at the manufacturing process and assess the promoter till we, you know, till the cows come home. But if it's not resulting in success in the marketplace, right, through market share gains, right, then it's all a little bit futile.
Absolutely.
Very interesting. So you know, final area in this, financial statements, you know, the CFA is like you and me, we are told that assessing financial statements is a big task. A big part of the CFA charter course is the financial statement analysis. What are the critical aspects of financial statement analysis that you focus on?
Obviously, I mean, the real analysis goes on, you know, evaluating the profitability of the company. So profitability in terms of comparing, because each industry has a, you know, different set of parameters that you look at. So you can't just analyze the company in isolation. Right. You got to understand the differences between that player and the rest of the player.
Right.
That difference is the most important for me. So I try to look at different parameters within the financial statements, where they're differentiating themselves and whether those factors are sustainable or not. So, I mean, that's the main thing. But obviously, I mean, the other ways of looking at it, whether what they're presenting in the financial statement itself, whether it's true or not.
Right.
You know, for that,
so taking a return on capital employed, company X with the peer group.
Yeah.
Is this is the ROC sustainable going forward?
Correct. And then you got to look at the various expenses items. You know, most of the expense items are comparable. You know, so if you look at whether it's the working capital as a percentage of sales compared to the others, whether it's the power cost, you know, whether it's the raw material cost, you know, how much value addition, you got to make sure that the value addition is the highest, even though at the industry level it might be lower, but comparatively it has to be the
compared to the peer group, it's the highest.
And for me, the margins that they make, you know, like for example, the steel pipes, you know, their EBITDA per ton, you know, that's the factor that you look at.
Because
the steel prices can go up and down, so the top line can go up and down just because it's a pass-through. And again, the EBITDA margins can keep on changing. So you can't look at that EBITDA percentage margin, but you got to look at EBITDA per ton and then compare it with the rest of the group. There's no one else who is even half of what.
Right. So it sounds like, you know, you're doing a good 6 to 12 months of work before you're reaching a conclusion on a company.
Right. I mean, sometimes it's, you know, 3 to 4 months work. Sometimes it's been 3 years or 4 years before. So you can do the work, but sometimes you just don't get that comfort.
Right.
You know,
so once you have the comfort, you go out and build the position, or is there a question of you take a small position, you watch some more, and then you gradually build the position?
I generally start very small.
Okay.
So I like to build, I do not mind buying higher prices.
Okay.
I'm not a falling knife catcher.
Okay.
I like to pick great businesses, you know, which I feel their you know, competitive advantage is going to last over the next 5-10 years. So even if I buy at X price, I bought at 6X price, you know, 3-4 years down the line. I'm completely fine. For me, if the management is delivering, if the competitive advantages are lasting and over the next foreseeable future, I just keep on building that position.
So let's assume you've, you know, done the diligence, built the position, and then you spot something in the annual report that worries you. So let's assume that you spot in the annual report that the promoter has paid his spouse the best part of 2 crores as a consultancy fee. How do you then deal with that? Do you sort of take the point of view that, well, the stock price hasn't moved, so I shouldn't worry, or do you actually take it up with management?
So if it's a new finding, which, you know, I did not catch before, obviously, you know, you got to reevaluate. But most of the times, you know, such management, whenever I have invested, I've invested in companies where, you know, they pay the spouses or the promoter takes really high salaries, but at least it's disclosed. So it's already deducted part of the net profit. So actually they are paying for it, because if the company is going to be valued at 30 times of,
right,
they are reducing the valuation, you know, and there is no way you can. So absolutely, I mean, it's not an acceptable thing, but there are different shades of, you know, gray.
Right.
For me, at least they are representing it rightly in the annual report, and I can take a calculated call. And if it fits into my valuation, for me, the most important part is the business and the strategy, whether their focus is right. They can do a lot of these things for tax savings and they can pay some other family members. Those are fine if they're disclosed and they're transparent in it.
Right.
But for me, the business strategy, if they are not good at it, then that's something where I would not touch.
So one of the distinguishing features of SageOne has been that your newsletters are exceptionally good. I mean, they're really, really good reads. And, you know, people like me who sort of earn a living writing, you know, for us, it's just really high quality stuff to read. But one of the things you keep pointing out is very high small and mid-cap valuations. I think you're one of the most eloquent commentators on very high small and mid-cap valuations. How has that observation that you've made, how has that impacted your investment process?
Yes, so I think one thing which I've observed, so you are exactly right. You know, the mid-cap and small-cap valuations are, I think, at more than historical highs, because I've done the comparison with the 2008 peak. At that time, the large-cap valuations are comparable to the large-cap valuations now, you know, the 27, 28 times around that. But the mid-cap and small-cap valuations then were all, you know, at 18 times.
Yeah.
At the peak in January.
Yeah, yeah.
Today, they are close to 30 times,
yeah,
you know, which is something that people don't really talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that whenever there is too much hope,
yeah,
you know, of the future, the benefit of doubt goes to all kinds of companies. People
right.
don't discriminate between high quality and low quality. And that's what has happened, that with the rising tide, everything has gone up.
Mm-hmm.
My experience has been that, you know, everywhere the 80-20 rule plays out, whether it's the GST benefit from unorganized to organized, the benefit will be sucked away by the top, you know, 80% of the benefit will be sucked away by the top 20% of the companies who have the right positioning, who have the competitive advantage, because the remaining player do not have the capability of, everyone cannot take market share away.
Right.
And those one or two players, they would justify the valuations they are trading at now. But the remaining players, I think they will come back to their historical valuations, which most of the history has been in single digits, but at least closer to the...
Right, and hence your strategy of focusing on market leaders.
Exactly.
Right, I can see. So you know, you're one of the few fund managers who sort of raised money domestically in the last 5-6 years, and also you've gone abroad to raise money. Is this valuation issue, is this a greater concern amongst the investors you meet abroad, or is it a greater concern in the domestic fraternity?
I think it's a much greater concern in the domestic fraternity.
Okay.
I think what I've seen is that the offshore investors, the institutional investors, they have really robust asset allocation.
I see.
So when they invest in India, you know, it's a very small portion of their net worth which they end up investing in India, and they understand the risks of valuation as well as the kind of volatility that a market like India can go through. Whereas domestically, what I've seen is that people tend to invest the most when everyone is positive. When I was raising money last time, you know, people were concerned about valuation.
Yeah.
But then the valuation kept on going up until December and January, and we had shut taking new subscriptions. And the most demand came in January when the markets were at the peak.
Yeah.
And so people were concerned, but then after a little while, they get too much confidence that now nothing can go really wrong, exactly at the wrong time. And that's when the, you know, markets...
And you've lived through 2000 and you've lived through 2007 and 2008, so I can see your sort of the memory flashing back in your head.
Yeah.
So last question, Samit, before we bring the interview to an end. Three books or three investors whose styles, whose philosophy have influenced you deeply?
So again, you know, I would like to categorize the books into something which really helps you in your investment thesis. Mm. Which is, you know, understanding the business.
Right.
For me, Michael Porter's books, you know, whether it's the competitive advantage, you know, there are books written by others too, you know, have helped me the most. So I think for any serious investor, you know, he has to read that book.
Right.
That's one. Second category is more which helps me, you know, just like your coffee can investing.
Mm.
Helps me filter and narrow down the universe.
Okay.
So for me, Joel Greenblatt, you know, he has phenomenal history.
Magic formula.
I mean, he has beaten even Warren Buffett, over his history, and very simple. Very simple formulas, but I design my own formulas.
So basically, mixture of ROC and price multiples to weigh up what you
should. So I have, you know, three or four parameters which I use to filter down and make sure that I need to eliminate most of the stocks so that I can focus on the right ones. So that Magic Formula book has helped me a lot. And then third category is more motivational, you know, entertaining, where, you know, you read about various fund managers, how they have generated alpha. So like Investment Gurus by Thanos, you know.
Right.
I really, because he talks about different fund managers, he has interviewed different fund managers, and they talk about how, you know, what is the strategy they have used to generate alpha.
Right.
And you'll see varied ways of doing that. And, you know, it takes you through their life, how they have developed, that passion and what they have done through their life. So motivational book, maybe not that useful in actually, but
creating the hypothesis.
Yeah. It just helps you just to, you know, go pump up and do more work. And try to do as good as what they have
done. I'm sure you'll carry on prospering and doing more work in the years to come. Thank you very much for that, Samit. That was very interesting. That brings to an end our interview with Samit Vartak, founder and CIO of SageOne Investment Advisors. I learned a lot over the last half an hour. I hope you did as well. And join us in future for other such interviews.